fire.
Out. Yeah, we better. Hi there. We better have a long way to go, man.
Yeah.
Oh yes.
Yeah.
I'm in no hurry.
I read your book with Barry. I told you where I got it for my son's letter.
Yeah.
I love the future more than you know.
What is the title for this? I love the future. I'm gonna tell Rosemary the moment I get home. Rosemary, this is about the book. Because I shared the book with her.
Right.
And so, I got, oh man, I better put down a letter from her son.
Yeah, that's good.
That's all I need. I have an accident on the way home, I get killed.
Oh my God, yeah.
Letter from...
There'll be problems. There'll be trouble right here in River City.
You got radio now from 66 through 70.
I would like to direct everyone's attention.
No, actually,
the right of the
90.
Stage.
90. Yeah, I forgot.
You got radio for 30 some years there.
Between the two of you?
Yeah, between the two of you. Yeah.
Not more?
It would be, are you 66 or?
There is a $5 charge.
No, for me it was, I left radio 2000.
Yeah.
I went to Sirius Satellite, but that was nothing.
That kind of counts.
Yeah, but
I would say that counts.
Yeah. You're
still on.
Yeah, no, I mean it counts, but
music to
but
the
not
masses.
For Cleveland, right?
Yeah, Vesta's catering party.
Yeah, but it was. But John and I can talk
thank
about all right, 66 right on through.
Please take advantage.
Why don't you interview him and you interview?
I mean,
well, we didn't talk about that, right, John?
Yeah.
As well what is that? What do we do?
Authors tent, right?
Does anyone care?
Oh, I think we'll
we care.
I think there's enough people out there that do care.
Yeah.
So I mean, we could tell the story. It goes back, you know, CKL.
Yeah, that I was there at 64.
Yeah, and the fact that that was the one station everybody
was
Mr. Gorman, West Side, where most of the AMs were.
That's what actually brought me here.
Yeah.
You know, Norm Wayne's listening.
Yeah.
And we were number one. I was number one. I was 7 to midnight, but it was number one in Cleveland.
Yeah.
But people do care, because the thing is, when were you in North Royalton at the library? You put on a talk.
That was about almost two years ago.
The place was packed.
Yeah.
People are still interested.
Oh, yeah, I know they are. I mean, they really are. I mean, I will get in if I'm in a crowd. At any given time, people will walk up. And they're not talking about 3WE, they're not talking about Q104, they're talking about WIXY.
Yeah. And they have vivid memories. That's the other thing is.
Because those were.
You have to remember. Yeah, okay, yeah, I do remember that.
Yeah, because we were talking about Murray Saul, and then we started going, what's he up to, and gotcha.
And I had the pleasure of working with Gorman, Glenn Gorman.
Yeah.
He was in sales at WIXY.
Oh,
and
wow.
I wonder how many people know that story.
Very few people know that.
Yeah, and he was. And one day, and you talk about character, we went to Len Gober's house, and I had never had grass in my life. I didn't touch that stuff. So, you know, there must have been eight couples. Wonderful. You know, totally unrelated, not radio people. As a matter of fact, Len and I were the only radio people, but newspaper people and friends. And Len was a white shirt and tie guy, because he was promoting Teen America or Miss.
What was that called? Teen Fair.
Yeah, Teen Fair.
Teen Fair USA.
And and so he got a job at WIXY as a salesman, and so we go to his house for a party, and all of a sudden after dinner we go to his big living room and there's like 16 chairs. And I thought, I wonder what we're going to do here.
Hey, wait a minute. I shouldn't be videoing this.
Oh, no. So we're...
Boom wouldn't mind.
Len's gone. Len's,
And Len wouldn't mind. Len would be the first to tell the story.
So we're sitting in these chairs, and Rosemary, my wife, said, what are we going to do? I said, I don't know. Tell stories? I don't know. I've never experienced anything like that. And all of a sudden, somebody lights up a joint. And just before it gets to us, Rosemary says, I'm not touching it. I said, well, neither am I, but act like we did.
Oh, that's good.
Anyway, shortly after that.
I did not inhale.
Well, shortly after that, this is the character of Len Goldberg. Len was getting grass from, I believe, his son or son-in-law from Vietnam.
Yeah, somebody
was sending grass to his house, and he lived in Shaker. And so we wake up, and on the front page of the Plain Dealer was a picture of the Shaker Heights police on his roof with the FBI.
No kidding.
Oh, and it was on the
front page. He was arrested. He was jailed.
Yeah, and they asked him where he worked, and he said, I'm not working anywhere. And so he would not embarrass the radio station. He said, I don't have a job, I'm not working anywhere.
Oh.
What character, huh? I mean, what?
You know, I mean, he spent a little time, months. But nonetheless, in those days, having marijuana was a serious offense.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And then after that, he couldn't get a job anywhere. And it was actually Billy Bass who got him into WMMS.
Mm-hmm.
And hired him just because he knew him from WIXY for a brief time. Mm-hmm. And just did a little favor to help Len out. And, you know, little did we know, that voice of his, I mean, he became such a powerhouse.
Oh, God. And became famous for, what, two words? What was it, Get Down? No.
That was Murray.
That was Murray Saul,
but what
yeah.
was, Len was what?
He was the top of the hour, WM.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, right. Right. Yeah, oh, yeah.
And he also did the oldie show on Sunday.
Yeah,
everybody loved that show.
It was spacey, though. I still remember I had a crystal radio. I was listening to it too.
Oh yeah.
But they went to still don't know how I picked it up.
Transistor radios in their ear. They would hide under the blanket. They would hide under the blanket with their transistor radios because their parents wanted them to go to sleep. And they were listening to The Wild Child on WIXY. You know what's amazing? Have the signals changed, John? I mean, I can't hear 1260. Almost anywhere.
Oh, here's the reason why. And I finally found out from an engineer. I said the same thing.
That's AM, correct?
There used to be a time, you know, that you could get, you can't get 1260 today. It's a Disney channel. Disney.
Really?
But you can't get a lot of AM radio stations inside a building. And FM the same way.
Yeah, yeah.
But with AM, what they used to do, this is what deregulation did. Because when everybody overpaid for the stations and can't afford to run them, every 3 years, you're supposed to replace the copper grounding around the AM towers. You need copper grounding to control, especially directional stations. Well, there hasn't been a station. I think the last station that replaced copper grounding was WKNR.
I mean,
the original KNR.
What does it do? Corrode or?
Yeah, you have to. You know, it's almost like changing your oil in a car. You have to do certain maintenance. And the trouble with FM. The reason why FM signals aren't as strong is, first of all, they parted off as much as you could. They portioned off parts of the signal for paging and this and that, which you can legally do. But then nobody has maintained the transmitters or anything else. These transmitters have a life expectancy. They're just running these things into the ground because nobody can afford to buy anything.
Isn't it? Because WIXY could be heard everywhere.
Yeah.
But at night, I remember we came back from one of our basketball games when the WIXY All-Stars, and I dropped off the Wild Child and Billy and the stuff, and we're standing in front of the radio station at 40th and Euclid. Can't hear it.
Yeah.
It was after 7 o'clock at night, at daylight, the signal goes one way. And then at dusk, it goes a different way.
At night, the atmosphere gets thicker, colder, and this thing.
Ah,
and
signals, that's the reason.
That's why you get the bounce. AM signals bounce, FM signals go straight into space.
Yeah.
So what happens is, if you didn't have these directional patterns, you'd have all this clashing between radio stations. And sometimes when you see an array of towers, like four or five towers in a row, those are AM towers. And they're directional. You have the towers will sort of force the signal away from a nearby station that may be on the same frequency.
Okay.
And, you know, FM is for the most part non-directional, although there are directional FMs too. But the trouble is, the reason why radio doesn't have the reach it used to is it's maintenance. Nobody's taking care of stations.
Oh, isn't that something?
They can't afford to.
So they start losing signal because of the corrosion and...
Yeah, well...
Or is it a galvanic action?
Well, it just doesn't go as... I don't know the technical reasons, but the signal just... It loses its power and it loses its strength.
Okay.
As time goes on. And then with FM, the more that you... take chunks out of that signal,
yeah,
the reach disappears. So that's the problem with FM right now.
I know, like 104.9, we listen to a lot of classic for the dogs. If we played rock, they'd be tearing the house up.
Now, 104.9 has another problem. When Bob Conrad, when they had that crazy sale on a number of stations,
yeah,
sold, Bob Conrad ended up with, because he wanted to keep classical on, the only thing he could get was a station license to Lorraine. The stick is an Avon.
Okay.
And it's only 3,000 watts, which is why CLV doesn't really get to.
Now, what's CLV again? What?
3 CLV is classic.
It's what, 90? Or
now it's one.
Is it 104.9?
104.9.
Okay. That's the one we're having problems getting, yeah, a lot of times.
And he sold it for a ton of money.
Yeah. And he did well. He was smart. He kept classical music and he also made some money on it.
Yeah, yeah.
But the other part is you can get it online. And a lot of, I see so many kids, especially younger kids, they're listening online. They're listening with their smartphones.
A green Malibu license plate, AVZ1357.
Yeah, that's the channel. That's what I keep saying. Everything is heading over to online.
DRF1111. If you could please move
did you guys ever do a show together at all, or did you ever have careers together in the same station, or just parallel, or
we've worked for some of the same people,
okay,
but not at the same time, but
yeah,
it's a family. There's,
you know, AM departed, and I was there from 66 to 72. AM lasted for about another 7 or 8 years. I went to 3WE now, and I was there for 10 years, and was still big numbers. Lanigan was over at GAR,
yep.
Gary D was in town, but in 1983, when did MMS kick?
It was the late 70s when it,
yeah,
started.
When it, yeah, and I remember I'm going to my daughters, my three young daughters, they were all young teenagers then. No, they weren't even teenagers. But I remember saying to them, I said, how many of your friends listen to your pop on the radio? I was on 3WE at the time. I said, Dad, none. We listen to this new station called The Buzzard. and my daughter said, was at the table one night. So she said, well, Dad, she said, you better get your butt over to FM or you're going to last a long time. And she said, I need to go to college, Dad, so you better get over to FM. And that was it.
Yeah. Well, Flash has three daughters. He asked one of his daughters, you know, what are you listening to? And he said, oh, I like country music. And Flash, what? You like country music? I mean, your father grew up with a, he worked at one of the best rock stations. He listened to country.
You know what we never realized? And Avery and I were talking about this the other day. I don't think we ever realized what a great voice Flash is.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And how good looking Jeff was. You know, when you remember when we did that thing with Levine?
Yes.
With Les Levine?
That was a great week.
That was a fabulous week. And Les Levine had all the radio guys on.
He had Lanigan one day. It was people that told great
stories.
And
Jeff was on with you, wasn't he?
No, Jeff was on his own.
Oh yeah, that you were alone.
Yeah,
you were on your own. That's right. And
you
I called in. I wanted to watch that whole week because I love all these guys, and we were all together. And when we were competitors, that was one thing, but we no longer competed. And it was wonderful to hear the stories. And when I was on, and then the next night, he was on, and I called him, and I can't even remember what it was, but it was great. And then Walt Taberski, who worked with him as the general manager of the station, ended up owning WQAL.
Yeah.
And so
that
he goes from my intern to owning the radio station. And when he was my intern, every day I'd walk in at 10 o'clock, I'd be there earlier, but before I go on the air at 10 o'clock, he'd walk up and give me a cup of coffee.
Yeah, Walt was always a good guy.
And he would go like this, Duker, here's your coffee.
Duker?
My first day, that was my nickname. And so my first day on his new radio station, he shows up, and it's a surprise to me. I open up the microphone, I'm scared to death, only because it's a new station, and I don't want to give the call letters of the old station. And I had not been on the air for about 3 months. And I said, good morning, everyone. I said, welcome to Q104. And Walt, and then just interrupts me. And I said, ladies and gentlemen, I said, this interruption is by the owner of the radio station, Walt Taberski. And then he said, I brought you coffee when I was your intern. And he said, and here I am. I now own the station. I'm your boss. I'm still bringing you coffee.
Walt was in town a couple of weeks ago.
I heard Tony Osepi told me. Yes. Tony said he talked to you.
Yeah, how is Tony? I didn't get a chance really to say much beyond him.
Yeah,
how is
Tony's
doing
great. We're working on a project together, non-radio. You know, I've been teaching at John Carroll. I teach leadership development, communication skills. And he has a shooting range on 50 acres of land.
No kidding.
In Florida. And his sons, one was a Navy SEAL, but they're big time military guys. One was in the Marine Corps, no, another was a Navy SEAL. They were police officers. And they have this incredible gun range. And so Tony knows that I teach. And he said, Larry, I'm putting a program together that executives would love to come be part of. Where he said, Larry, I'll teach entrepreneurial skills. Your buddy who teaches leadership development with you, PhD, teaches the leadership development, and you teach communication skills, executive communication skills.
Oh, wow.
And he said, so we're putting that program together. But when we first met, he said, Larry, so I was talking to John Gorman, right? Was he talking to you?
Yeah. Oh, wow.
I thought he said that. And so that was that.
But it's funny, Walt is unchanged. Yeah, Walt came in, it's like, I hadn't seen Walt for about 4 or 5 years. Unchanged. Nothing changed.
None.
Still the same guy.
Now, next question. Who's the most famous person that you've had at your stations?
In our
station? And we could go on this philosophical thing, who's famous and...
President Reagan.
Really?
Yeah,
that would have to be...
Yeah, President Reagan. There are a lot of stars, you know, a lot of stars. One of the interviews that I'll never forget was, I wanted to hear the interview, Bruce Springsteen.
Oh, wow.
Is in town, he was just on the cover of Time magazine.
He's a great guy. He went to that, what was the brewery that was in the powerhouse? Rock Bottom?
Rock Bottom, yeah.
Left like a $100, $200 tip for him and was signing autographs, you know, people coming.
Well,
great guy.
The last time Springsteen was in town.
But I didn't mean to cut you off.
After the show, he went to Sokolowski's.
Okay.
And that's where they had dinner. That's where all the dinner, everybody with the band, all the workers, all had dinner at Sokolowski's.
Well, my wife's boss is a big fan of his.
Well, he's in town and Kid Leo's going to interview him. And I want to hear the interview. And so I hopped in the car. It was late in the afternoon. And
I mean, I was a nervous wreck.
Oh, and here's the way the interview goes. It's like 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Kaleo says, Bruce Springsteen, the boss is in town. I don't know whether they called him the boss at that time or not.
Yeah, they're still there.
Yeah. And he says, the boss is here. Here's the way the interview goes. He says, hey, man, what's happening? Bruce Springsteen said, it sounded like two guys were high as a kite. And Bruce says, yeah, baby, it's great to see you. So for about 10 minutes, all you got was, hey, baby, what's going down? And I thought, what is going on with this interview? I said, Gorman's got to have a fit.
The way I looked, I said, no matter what people are listening, I'll always be talking about this one.
Forget about it, right?
The other thing with Springsteen is he never did any drugs. In his life, he's never done anything.
Oh, isn't that wonderful?
Well,
occasionally has a drink. He's really...
he's healthy.
Yeah. And, I mean, look at he's 63, I believe. And he can still move and do all that.
You know what they all do? I mean, the one thing I liked about our generation is many of the people... I'm a little older than what John is and a little older than what Springsteen is. And,
really?
Oh, yeah.
You guys don't look it
but
at
not
all.
By much.
But not by much. but I'm older. And so, and I am surprised how many guys on one side of the ledger have not taken care of themselves and they're gone.
Yeah.
Or have gotten unlucky. On the other side, I got about 5 guys my age that are still like 40 years old.
Yeah.
Think young and do things at all. Man, it's wonderful.
You see that with some performers. They still look young. They still act. Neil Young, you know, look at how at his age and he's still active.
Yeah.
But then you look at from the same band, Stephen Stills.
Yes.
Oh. He's, you know, he's gained a lot of weight. He's had health problems and all
but
that.
You know what? You could put that whole band together, man, and
they still can do it.
Still can do it, and people would love to hear it.
Yeah.
Just love to hear it.
But yeah, we saw Springsteen on Palladio, and that's why, you know, when you're talking about that international flavor that the internet's bringing. Yep. Well, even like on TV now, you watch, there's Springsteen out in Europe just rocking out, and they're loving him. They can relate to him out there even.
Yeah.
So
it's the biggest. Springsteen had the biggest tour in Europe this summer. It was the number one tour in Europe this summer. Bruce Springsteen,
can you imagine?
At 63 years old.
Well, because this generation still loves it.
Exactly.
And, you know, they're moving right through the pike. You know, the baby boomer boy just moving right through the pike, and they're all there. We're all there.
So what happened with Reagan? We kind of went from Reagan to Bruce Springsteen real quick.
Oh, no, I was really fortunate. I became the president's man for a while.
Really?
It was Carter first.
Okay.
Then I introduced Reagan. Then Herbert Walker Bush. And then President Clinton.
Okay.
And so I became sort of the president's man. I don't know how that ever happened, but it was great. I'll never forget when I tell the story in the book. Bob Bennett was the chairman of the Republican Party for the state of Ohio. Remember, Bob?
Yeah.
And he called me one day, and we had both been in the Marine Corps, so... and I always put it on him because he was a captain and I was a major, so I put it on him. I said, hey, man, you always have to salute me, you know, because you're a younger rank than myself. But anyway, so he... called me one day and he said, Larry, he said, Reagan's coming tonight. I said, I heard that. And he had been shot, but he had not made any appearances. And the first appearance since then is going to be Cleveland. So the press corps would be all over the place. And he called and he says, Reagan's coming tonight. I said, oh, congratulations, Bob. I think that's really wonderful. And he said, we're sitting around wondering who we could get to introduce him. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, who'd you get? I really think it would be a politician or somebody like that. And he said, we all decided that you should be the person to introduce him.
Well, you guys got great talking voices.
And so that was a big deal for me.
Very good.
So, that turned out to be a part of my life. That you know, you're never looking in our business, and John knows this, most of us who have been around in the area where radio is king.
Yes.
You know, when you're competing against people, but you don't compete to be better. You just do your thing, but you do compete to be different. You know, and MMS really separated itself from the pack. WIXY did.
And there were two kinds of people in radio: the ones that really enjoyed what they were doing, loved the craft, had great personality. And then you had people who were just the traveling. They were the traveling salesmen. They'd be in a market for 2 years, and then you know they didn't go to another market. They're all trying to get to New York or LA.
And there were the jocks that came through WIXY and some at 3WE. Gosh, they were.
Yeah.
And you're right, man. They were floaters. They were here today and gone tomorrow, and it would break your heart to see them move on, and especially WIXY.
Yeah.
You know, we had about five that stayed, and I mean, Billy wasn't even there anymore.
So,
Billy Bass wasn't there.
Okay.
But boy, it was... one of the great stories with Billy is that, and I tell the story in the book, is Billy Bass, obviously being African American, replaced the Wild Child, who had these incredible ratings, 29 and 30 shares at night, and so Billy wasn't being promoted. I had a card with my name on it, Mike Ranieri, and all of us, and we weren't promoting him at all. So he goes to Norm Wayne, and he says, who owned the station, he said, Norm. He said, how come you don't promote me, man? He said, I'm the night man here. He said, how come you don't promote me? And Billy said, I mean, Norm Wayne said, Billy, are you crazy? He said, you're black.
Oh.
Billy said, so? And that's when they were burning the city down. We had the riots of 66 and then turned around again in 68. And then from that point on, we started to promote Billy. I remember when I took the basketball team, WIXY All-Stars, to Lakewood, and we bring Billy. Billy's a great basketball player. And so I introduce all the guys. Here's Mike Ranieri. Everybody gets a great hand. Introduce Billy Bass, standing ovation, and bring the house down. And Norm Wayne was there. From that moment on, Billy became our star. And then he goes to MMS.
And see, a lot of it too is the younger kids, they didn't have, I mean, you see it today, they didn't have the same you know, fear, the same kind of racism and all that. And each generation loses that much more of it. And this was the first generation that you're listening to Motown, you're listening to a lot of black artists, you're going to, you know, basketball games where you're dealing with, and football where you're dealing with a lot of black athletes. The next generation wasn't looking at, well, that player's black or that player's white. It was like, that player's good or that player's not good. It was a different game entirely. You know?
Exactly.
And today you look back and you wonder, how was it ever like that? Well, you know, that was only 30, 40 years ago.
Do you think we slipped a little bit? Or?
I think we're going in the right direction.
Okay, good. Yeah.
Yeah,
for the most part, we're going in the right direction. I mean, we have a black president. Who would have thought? Who would have thought that 10 years ago?
Black,
with a name
black mayor.
Yep. Well, and in the case of mayors, you know, a lot of urban areas, you know, where you had the white flight, you had a lot of people moving into the suburbs, and they were replaced with blacks. So that's why a lot of black mayors suddenly appeared, because you had a larger population of blacks moving into the city. You know, Cleveland's example was, Cleveland won World War II, along with Detroit and Toronto, the Great Lakes area, really won the war. But part of it was, in Cleveland, you had a large influx of blacks that came from Alabama into Cleveland because there was work. There was
I didn't know that's where they came. Okay.
Yeah. And most of the blacks from Cleveland came from Alabama initially. And you also had a lot of Eastern Europeans who were working in the coal mines in Pennsylvania and West Virginia that came in because you suddenly have better paying jobs and you're working in a factory above ground and all that. And there was plenty of work in Cleveland. But after the war ended, and you looked at the population, well, Cleveland had a large black population. I think it was probably one of the larger black populations a northern city had, and a large population of Eastern Europeans.
Exactly. And that's where my mom and dad.
Different times. And the Eastern Europeans brought with them their accents because they, you know, was first, second, third generation, and still carry the accents with them. So they were looked at, here's the Cold War begins the day after World War II ends, and they're being looked at as, they sound like Russians. You can't trust those Eastern Europeans. So they were sort of close to them. And then because of that whole Eastern European culture, you have all these countries that are postage stamp sized countries that don't get along with one another. Mm-hmm. You had, you know, all the Slovenians lived here, all the Polish lived here, all the Latvians lived over here. You know, everybody...
How did you know?
Well, but you know what I'm saying is that you had a city now that had a large black population and a large population of Eastern Europeans that the lily white people who lived in Cleveland mm-hmm. could not... What's going on here? You also had the GI Bill that's now allowing you to move to the suburbs. But unlike a lot of cities that grew by annexing, yeah. You know, most major cities own the water supply. So as these suburbs start developing, it's like, well, if you want our water, you have to become part of the city. Cleveland looked at it the other way. The leaders in Cleveland, you suddenly had a lot of Eastern European leadership getting in the politics mm-hmm. within the city limits, mm-hmm. and you had a larger amount of blacks who were getting into politics within the city limits. And it turned out to be racism on both sides.
Mm-hmm.
Shaker Heights and Cleveland Heights and Lakewood did not want those Eastern Europeans or those blacks moving into the suburbs.
Yeah.
But at the same point, the blacks and Eastern Europeans that had moved into Cleveland from elsewhere and are finding, you know, they're now living in the city are saying, if we assimilate with the suburbs, if Lakewood and Shaker Heights and all mm-hmm. become part of Cleveland, we'll lose our political clout, we'll lose all of that. So both sides were saying, we don't want to annex. You know, Shaker Heights went as far as to change, you know, Kinsmen became chagrined.
Yeah,
you know,
yep, that's right.
Buckeye became South Woodland.
Yeah.
And every side street that went from Cleveland to Shaker Heights, they put barriers. The only way that you could get from Cleveland to Shaker Heights was one of the main Ohio routes, you know, 322, 422, whatever like that. But what happened is it was this invisible line that, and I remember when I first, and this is 1973, when I first moved to Cleveland. I lived in Cleveland Heights for a short time, and there used to be, and this is Cleveland Heights, there used to be a police car at the top of the hill.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
On Euclid Heights Boulevard. If you went up Cedar Hill, and if mm-hmm. you were black driving up that hill, that police car came around and said, what are you doing here?
Yeah, get him out of there.
And we also had one by Mayor White, too, by close to, what is it, University Circle, I believe?
Yeah. Well, that was different. Those were different. He had to have.
Oh, yeah.
That was different. But in those days, it was, the suburbs did not want the blacks moving there. And at the same point, there was a period of time where the blacks wanted to have, and the Eastern Europeans were saying, why should we move elsewhere when we can have a political base? It didn't work. Cleveland really fell apart because it was losing it, because it didn't annex at the right time. And that's why Cuyahoga County, that's why you had the Demora problem, because you had 59 different municipalities in one county. So it becomes very easy when you're a county government leader to say, well, if you don't do what I want, I'll have that factory move from Valley View to Garfield Heights, and those are the games that were played.
You know what, I did in 1983, did an East-West Symposium, and decided, or wanted to know,
why people on the east side didn't go west and the people on the west side didn't go east.
Good afternoon again, ladies and gentlemen.
We didn't have a 480 then.
Just a few minutes
exactly.
Here.
We didn't have an I-9.
We didn't, yeah. And so...
And boy, when it opened up, it was like the Autobahn.
But I'll never forget, I had, first of all, I had the mayors from each of five communities on the west side.
So if everybody wanted
this was the result. Police chiefs, from educators, from mayors, and stuff like this, and from
people
on the east side didn't go west because they thought all these stupid people lived on the west side, that they were all Parmaites, that they all wore white socks, and that they were great thinkers, and so nobody went west. The people who lived on the west side didn't come east because the blacks and the Jews were on the east side.
Huh.
And that's where a lot of the crime was, and they didn't care for the... all the museums, they didn't care for all that stuff. And that was the result of that terrible thinking, which was not true. Now some of the greatest suburbs that we have are Avon, Rocky River, Bay Village, Lakewood, all that. And then, of course, the eastern suburbs are what they are. Wonderful. But but 480 and 90 changed all that.
Yeah. I mean, I remember when I first moved to Cleveland, you
also,
literally
ladies
could
and gentlemen,
not get
starting in just
from one place
a minute
to the other.
Or two in the
you
culinary
could not
arts
go,
tent.
You could not take a direct route
catering
except
is going
for
to be doing a
to
delicious
to, from the east side
prep
to the west
cake
side.
Demonstration.
But that was right along the show.
$5
I mean, if you get to Lakewood eventually.
Wonderful. Well, I hated going down Brook Park. There's parts of my Trans Am all over that road.
If you lived on the east side and you had to catch a plane, that was the...
Oh, yeah.
You had snow.
Remember, we would take, even before 90 was finished, we would take
also,
422
we had
down to 77.
Okay.
77 into town.
Anybody wanted
71 out of town to the airport. Unreal.
My buddy used to do that, and I'm like, that's a lot of mileage there. Why don't you just... And then
but
when
even
I,
before 480.
That was just crazy.
I know. There was a time, I-90, you go from Boston to Seattle. And the only unfinished part was Cleveland.
We have the truck from Ohio Farm Direct.
You had to get on I-71, go to the turnpike, and then take the turnpike to Elyria around 80 and 90.
Remember the way they would get to the islands? They'd have to take Route 2.
We have Zydeco
to take
Bistro,
Route 2 along Lake Erie, all the way to the islands. That was the only way you could get there.
And that was a long drive.
Yeah, that was a long drive.
Fried lake perch dinner.
I used to hate it when I go to make an appearance at the islands. Go out to Lakewood and grab two, and it was awful. It'd take me 3 hours to get there.
Was that that mile long bar or whatever they got down? We used to have a blast out there.
Part of that reason is true. The reason why Cleveland was so isolated was because you had
lemon chiffon.
Everything that could go wrong went wrong. You had those 59 different municipalities in Cuyahoga County. But then you also had the roads were incomplete. You know, none of the interstates. Even I-77 was incomplete. I-77 started downtown.
And now, without further ado,
then it stopped in Cuyahoga Heights by the steel mill.
Magic Mike is
you had to get on
all over Northeast
21,
including
and take 21 to Rockside Road,
just down the way
and then
across
get back
the
on Rockside. Go on Rockside,
Magic
take a right, and then
the fine art
almost a mile down
education.
The road, you could pick up I-77 again.
Later,
but yeah, I mean, you couldn't get there, and Cleveland was so isolated because there was no easy way to get into the city. You know, it really hurt business because there was no reason. You'd find a way to bypass Cleveland by taking I-71. And I-71 was the only completed interstate from downtown. You could get on I-71 and take that all the way to, West Virginia. That was it.
The whole two of them right over here, absolutely.
So it's changed quite a bit.
There you go.
It really has. And hopefully it's making a comeback. We got MedMart coming. And
I'm saying when the Medical Mart opens, it will not be called the Medical Mart. That will never happen. It will be a convention center, but I don't believe it will be a medical center. That was a scam that was done to the city. It was just not right. But the other side of it is, Cleveland has so many things going for it. I mean, we do have good restaurants. We have a lakefront. We have an incredible parkland. And I didn't even know about this park, but I mean, the metro parks alone, the towpath and the lakefront and all that. You know, we have all of these things. We have great museums. We have an art museum.
Yes, we
do. Turning into a real, it used to be a mediocre art museum, now it's a great art museum.
World-class orchestra.
And we have the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, which is the biggest draw that Cleveland has, and the biggest draw Ohio has right now. But we don't have, that every other city has, it becomes a destination of shopping. And, you know, I keep saying that we need shopping rises. Why not turn Cleveland into having the largest outlet mall, the largest high-end outlet mall, not just an outlet mall like Aurora Farms or the one that's
kind of competing with Minnesota's great mall?
One that is selling Armani suits and, you know, top-of-the-line designer and all that, but it's an outlet.
They'd have to get me back to work first before I get an Armani, though.
Well, yeah, but I mean, but the fact is that you would have people coming from
I hear you.
Upstate New York, you'd have them coming from Chicago, you'd have them coming from Michigan, you'd have them coming from even Canada, coming into shop where you could get these, you know, expensive clothes for less, for a lower price. That's the hook that Cleveland needs. And the Midwest is very practical. Cleveland is the gateway to the Midwest. The Midwest is very practical. You know, when they tried to put a high-end mall in downtown Tower City, where you had Gucci and all those places having stores, it was a bomb because people in Cleveland, people in greater Cleveland, are looking for bargains. They're looking for the best price. You're not looking to just be wearing the latest
fashion. The big lots and those outlets.
But if you had something where you offered high-quality clothing, and it was overstocked, and it was coming from designers, you would get people coming in, you know, whatever, 600-700 mile radius, definitely a 500-mile radius coming in to Cleveland. That's the only thing that's missing from this area, right?
We got to sell Cleveland.
Yeah. So, eventually we'll get it.
I'll be in there rotting away.
Okay.
Yeah. He has in there, but I already have it.
Do you want me to autograph?
Good luck.
Okay. Who's it going to?
What do you charge him for this?
It's okay.
Not me.
What
are
you talking?
$15.
Wow.
I want one. It's for my hippie.
Thanks for hanging out with me today.
Hey, thank you very much, sir. I appreciate it.
Great.
And I'll...
Did you put the 20 here? This?
Not yet.
Okay.
And what prompted you to write it?
Okay, I'll tell you.
Okay.
Peter, I was actually asked to write this book by David Gray a couple of years ago. And when David asked me to write the book, I told him, I said, can I really be honest with you? Who in the world cares about anything that I might have to say about radio or whatever? And he said, well, Larry, said, I have followed your career for 40 years. He said, I'd like to know what it's like to be on stage with the President of the United States 4 times, different times. And he said, what's it like to stand in front of 450,000 people, you know, for a bicentennial? And he said, what's it like to be backstage with all these stars that you've interviewed? He said, so why don't you take us backstage? And that's when I got excited about writing the book. And that was 2 years ago. To encapsulate the book is to say it's a my life on and off the air, stories from 4 decades. And I was very fortunate to have arrived in Cleveland in 1966 to go on the air with a brand new radio station that ended up with the highest ratings in Cleveland and then the highest AM ratings in America. And a lot of wonderful things have happened to me since I came to Cleveland, and it's all in this book.
Thank you very much.
So you're very welcome. And thank you, Peter. It was great hanging out with you today.
Same here. Thank you, sir.